When we worked on Womanhouse in 1972, Karen LeCocq and I were inspired to do Leia's Room after reading a novel, The Last of Cherie, by the French author Colette. This novel focused on a theme of aging and loss. Leia, an aging courtesan, and her young lover, who she called Cherie, became reunited after a separation of 6 years. He was shocked that Leia's hair had turned gray and she had gained weight. Working collaboratively with Karen, we created a very beautiful but suffocating bedroom that helped show the pain and loss that comes with aging. Karen sat in our room at the vanity table, continually applying makeup. Thinking back 50 years later, it's ironic that we were dealing with the concept of aging when we were in our early 20s. We had slender bodies with perfect skin. Lately, I've been thinking a lot about aging and the losses that come with it. When I was a kid, I thought anyone old was always old. I never imagined that they were once young. For example, there was an elderly grandmother across the street that everyone called Muddy. She sat in a chair in the living room, and in my young mind, she had always been sitting in that chair, old and shriveled. I would often go with my mother to visit Muddy. I loved it because she gave me black licorice. She would take the pieces out of an oblong white box that had wax paper separating the licorice sticks. She would cut it into pieces with small scissors and give them to me. One of the granddaughters told me not to eat it because the scissors were used to cut Muddy's toenails. But I didn't care and ate it anyway. Most of my life is now behind me. I used to think that getting older meant having some wrinkles and gray hair and not much else. When I was almost 70, I had a couple of dog walking accidents that one resulted in a serious fracture that required multiple surgeries. And I got a serious staph infection from the first surgery. I started seeing profound changes in my body that I was completely unaware would happen. Recently, another accident related to my dog has caused a complete tear of my Achilles tendon, hence this boot I have to wear. I'm thinking of the phrase, you're only as old as you feel. But what if your body feels much older than its actual years? My mother-in-law lived to be 99 and a half. She would tell me that when she looked in the mirror, she didn't know who the old lady was, because inside she felt the same as she always did when she was young. Now I'm beginning to understand what she meant. June is my birthday month. I am 74. I'm realizing that my thinking, if only I exercised more, ate healthier, and lost weight, is not going to bring my youthful body back. But in spite of all this, I have remained optimistic, and I am truly honored to be part of Womanhouse 2022.
you do the dishes.
Well, they're your dishes as much as mine.
But you don't have a cock.
What's that got to do with it?
A cock means you don't wash dishes. You have a cunt. A cunt means you wash dishes.
I don't see where it says that on my cunt.
Stupid. Your cunt pussy gash hole, or whatever it is round like a dish. That means you wash dishes. My cock is long and hard and straight and meant to shoot like guns or missiles. Anyone can see that. Speaking of shooting, I need to shoot off, that is. You know, drop my load, shoot my wad, get my rocks off. I have to, you know. Come, that is. I have to come. I, me, I have to, I need to, I must, I.
Was it all right? Did I do it right?
Yes, it was fine. Now let's go to sleep.
You know, sometimes I wish I could come too.
Now you know you don't need to come like I do. Your cunt was made to receive.
I know. My cunt was made to receive. My cunt has an opening in the middle. Therefore, I must receive. My cunt is shaped like a dish. Therefore, I must wash dishes. My
I have a cunt and it is locked and hard and straight and meant to shoot like guns or missiles. I have a cunt, I must shoot, I must shoot, I have a cunt, I must shoot, I must shoot, I have a cunt, I must shoot, I have a cunt, I must shoot, I must shoot. You know, if you keep making all these demands on me, like asking me to wash dishes and wanting to come and everything, you're going to castrate me.
Castrate you?
Yes, castrate me.
Castrate you?
Yes, castrate. Castrate. Castration. Castration. Castrate.
Thank you. us.
I suppose this is it. Heaven?
No, no.
Hell?
No.
Purgatory. Yes. Yes. Limbo. Nothing left to do but go mad, I suppose. Hello? Ah. Worth a shot. God, I miss it. I miss the world. I remember as a kid, I used to catch trout in the brook out back. Small things. No longer than a pen. But I just keep them around. Clenched in my fat little fist, its eyes all bugged out from the pressure in its guts. I'd slap it down next to my fork at dinner, and I'd eat chicken nuggets with my greasy little fingers. They were my dead friends. And my mom would have to pluck them out of my grasp after I'd fallen asleep like Indiana Jones. See, I didn't know I was killing them. I didn't even know it hurt. But That's back when I used to sneak into my parents' bed at night. I'd wait to hear the snoring, and then I'd pad my way up the stairs like a cat dragging my teddy bear. I remember this one night, just as I was about to crawl in, and my pops rolls over, and I hit the ground like there's a nuke in the air. And my mom's hunched over the mattress like a gargoyle, and she's saying, it's okay, you can come up. And I'm scooting my way under the bed, and I'm breathing in the dust bunnies, and I'm saying, Pops is gonna be mad. And I was just terrified. Terrified of the anger. Why am I even talking? Hello? God, I could use a drink. Like those drinks I used to make Pops. Damn lighter fluid those were. I mean, there I was, head barely over the countertop, and I'm tilting the handle of vodka at a cup full of ice and splashing some Coke in for flavor. I don't know if I knew what it was, but I knew how Pops liked it. S-T-R-O-N-G. That's why Mom left. I guess it's not the only reason. I mean, there was the axe thing. See, I don't know if it was a joke or not, but that thing was well over his head, and Mom looked like a doe in the road. And then it just dropped to the ground, and it was over, and I think we went fishing. I got a new dead friend, and the axe thing never happened, I guess. See, sometimes it was like she was married to the devil. But nobody's the devil. But we're all the devil. Anyone there? No. It's no one. Pops would tell me about how his mom's husband would smack him around. I mean, this was Pops. Biceps like softballs, and he's getting slapped around by some old drunk who dropped out of school. He was just a boy, though. Like me. I guess all the kids slept in the attic back then. You know, too small a house, too many kids adopted from other marriages. And that old man would slap them all around. Except Pop's sister. See, he'd start in on her and Pops would do something. Something like toss a plate at the wall or crack a chair arm. Man, did that make that old fucker mad. And Pops would get twice the beating. See, but anytime he talked about it, he'd laugh. He'd say, he sure did mop the floor with me. And he'd laugh and laugh, and I'd laugh too. Except I didn't know why I was laughing. Anyway, by the time the late night news rolls around, Pops is always snoring on the sofa. Cup of ice clenched in his hand like a dead trout. I'd wait for the right time, and I'd put him to bed. See, the thing about Pops is, you wake him too late, and his back hurts from sleeping on the sofa. But you wake him too early, man, and he's still in dreamland. And he comes out of it swinging. Eyes closed and shrieking and throwing around those big knobby knuckles. I don't know who he was swinging at, but it wasn't me. Even if he did connect a few times, it wasn't me. It wasn't me. It wasn't me. Hello? 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 He'd keep vodka and water bottles. Maybe so he could have them in the truck cup holder, but maybe not. I remember this one night. I woke up thirsty, and I grabbed one, and I started chugging it. Of course, then the fire hits my throat, and I sprayed that crap all over the kitchen. And it wakes up Pops. And when Pops comes out, sees what I've done, sees the mess that I've made, he just made me eat bread. I mean, two idiots sitting in the dark, chewing Wonder Bread. And he won't quit asking, you okay? You okay? How's your stomach? You okay? I mean, it was funny even then. He drinks a bottle and he sleeps like a baby. But I get a thimble's worth and the sky falls. He just wouldn't quit asking, you okay? You okay? Eat some more bread. You okay? Is anyone listening? I guess it'll just be like this forever. I guess we'll just be like this forever.
Actually, I dropped out of art school. Don't you get that that's better?
You're not properly educated. You don't know what you're doing. You're asking for too much. Why don't you do something to benefit your community? Read the room. Actually, we changed this entire structural network, and I'm not exactly sure how you fit into this ecosystem. Why don't you start with some cleaning? You'd be a better administrator. I'm not actually into post-structuralism.
I'm pattern and decoration.
You need to watch what the others are doing and then be quiet. You need to look at your surroundings and blend in. You need to fit in. Actually, excuse me, try muting yourself. You need to move on. You need to stop acting so resentful. You need to be quiet. Are you okay? Why are you acting so mad? You need to stop being so aggressive. Actually, I understand your need to process, but you need to do your own emotional labor. I believe in you, but there's really nothing I can do to help you.
Wow. My house is not my home. Instead, I live in my video games, where I can explore worlds that are far from the yelling. My house is not my home. Instead, I live in my books, where I can imagine a perfect, unbroken family. My house is not my home. Instead, I live at church, where my video games are evil, my books are a distraction, and my sexuality is wrong. My house is not my home. Instead, I live in the hospital where I almost died from chemotherapy. My house is not my home. Instead, I live at school where I can help until late at night to avoid going to the house. My house is not my home. Instead, I live in my phone, where I can be myself. My house is not my home. Instead, I live at my boyfriend's apartment, where I'm uncomfortable. My house is not my home. Instead, I live in the house I bought with my boyfriend, where my voice cracks from the yelling. My house is not my home. Instead, I live at work, where I can stay late as an excuse again. My house is not my home. Instead, I live in my community, where I can help others that are like me. My house is not my home. Instead, I live at my friend's house, where I'm not alone. My house is not my home.
Dear Dad, I'm writing you this letter to tell you the things I was never able to say. I was born and quickly assigned pronouns of he, his, him. I'm the carrier of the family name. In your eyes, I was born into an expectation of control, power, strength, anger. You saw all the manly things except intimacy and weakness and vulnerability. Yes, those are manly too. Even at an early age, I felt the pressure grow in my bones, fed by your mantras. Walk it off. It don't hurt. Be a man. Grow a pair. Don't cry. I was not the boy you dreamt I'd be. You began forcing me into a mold of what you saw as your ideal son. Trucks, footballs, toy guns, tools. Action figures. Aren't those really just dolls too? My body contorted as I grew. You watched as I became a vision of you. I conformed, knowing, not knowing what felt right. Who was I to you? Did it matter who I was to myself? I was never enough though. I was too weak, too small, too slow, too much of a sissy. And yet, I was just me. Your judgment took hold and I played along with your stereotypes as the excuses came. Late bloomer, I just need to eat more, put more meat on my bones. It's mom's fault for coddling me. Honestly, when I didn't make you proud, your anger raged, verbal, then physical. I'll give you something to cry about. No son of mine will act like that in my household. Get a haircut, you look like a girl. That was then. I couldn't defend myself from your demons. But now, in defiance, I say, fuck you. See, I can be strong. I can be angry too. Was that wrong? Can't you take a joke? You seem confused. Did I question your masculinity, or was that all just a show? Who am I to you now, when I realize I may not be who you expect me to be, but I know who I am, and that's enough to be what a real man means to me. Love your son.
I was going out that Saturday after a difficult week. I quit my job at the sandwich shop on the spot when the guy I was working with came up to me while I was stocking snacks, touched my hair, walked back and stood there next to the cash registers, staring at me and masturbating. I was so shocked and confused, I just walked out without getting my paycheck. I really shouldn't have been surprised, though. People can be such assholes. I quit my last job for similar reasons. I just got worn down by the macho, mansplaining attitude at work, where all the guys also expected me to be sexually available and go out for drinks. So yeah, I shouldn't have been surprised, and yeah, I tried to just move on. I had a blast getting ready to go out with my friends and doing my hair. I wore my new jeans, and on my way out the door, my mom complimented my hair for once instead of saying something snide like, "Hey, you look like you need a trim." We went out to hear some music, had a few drinks. I went over to my boyfriend's house to crash, and I was realizing I was so shocked and exhausted from the long week I had exams at school and all the bullshit at my former job that I just wanted to crash on the couch like I used to do when we were friends. No big deal. I woke up with his hand in my hair and his tongue in my mouth. Normally, this would be awesome, but I really was not in the mood. "Stop it," I said. "Can't you wait until morning? Come on." His hand on my hair got harder. "You're seriously scaring me right now," I said, and his grip got firmer. His weight pinned me down. He unbuttoned my jeans and I disassociated. "Stop it," I was saying, squirming away. And the guy I thought was my boyfriend raped me. You know what? I didn't just move on. I told our principal and our homeroom teacher. The teacher made me feel awful. She was like, "I've been meaning to schedule a meeting with your parents. Why don't you spend less time twiddling with your hair, focusing on fashion, and more time focusing on your work? Stop complaining about people in our community." Well, I didn't stop complaining. I took it to the principal. I felt awful sitting there telling him about what happened, and all he said was, "Isn't he your boyfriend? You should show some sympathy. You know he's been having trouble at home. Stop creating problems in our community." But you know what? I didn't stop creating problems. I took it to court. I had to sit there in front of judges and lawyers and tell what happened over and over. The same predictable questions. What were you wearing? How many drinks did you have? But you know what? Having a few drinks and wearing what I want is not a crime, and the guy got convicted. I still feel gross and ashamed sitting here in front of you telling something that happened to me. Imagine, I'm ashamed talking about something that happened to me when all those people in my community felt totally fine covering up rape.